introduced is about the tools to allow productive deployment of artificial neural network and in general machine learning algorithm on off-the-shelf cheap and low-power microcontrollers. So there are three topics today. Let me go through the first one. The first one is about the tool I just mentioned. So, sorry. It's not this one. I don't know why it's show me this. Okay, it should be this one. Okay, so first of all, the tools that I develop are focused on a methodology which is composed by mainly five steps. When we develop an application, when we try to solve a machine learning problem, essentially, there are, as far as supervised learning is concerned, there are five steps to go through. First of all, to define a problem. A problem means, for example, I would like to use a sensor, a microphone to recognize the keywords, or I would like to use an inertial sensor to recognize my activity, or would like to use an image camera to recognize my face or my gestures, and so on and so forth. So here the central point is the sensor selection. Then the next step is to create a data set which capture the input-output relation which univocally define my problem. This typically is the longest part of the project in terms of time. 80-90% of the time is spent in creating such a data set, and for capturing a real problem, even more is needed to check carefully the data and make sure that labels are correctly associated to the raw data. Once this is done, usually AI scientists use off-the-shelf popular deep learning frameworks to design and train a machine learning approach, a neural network, for example, to solve the problem. Now, there are two main domain frameworks which are today well established. First of all, 70-80% of the AI scientists uses Google tools, and therefore TensorFlow, Keras, and the associated evolutions. The second are all those tools that uses a common intermediate representation format, which is called ONNX. And therefore, PyTorch, MXNet, PaddlePaddle, and the like, usually export the data in such a format. We see less pervasiveness of this format. However, it's part of the ecosystem. Once a neural network is properly trained, it is exported in a file format. And these are de facto standard. ONNX is also another the Google one are de facto standard. The ONNX is de facto is another standard, as I say. Then we need to map such a neural network on, and this is what interests me in particular, on off-the-shelf microcontroller. Now the company does a lot of STM32 for IoT and also for automotive. The so-called Chorus SPC58 microcontroller. Now, the point here is that this representation exported by the deep learning tool cannot be deployed as it is on a microcontroller. Now, there are three main technologies to achieve that. One is to develop interpreters. For example, I would like to remind TensorFlow Lite Micro is an interpreter which scale a lot between different microcontrollers in order to implement inferences. The other is a compiler. A compiler typically is needed to drive, to generate microcode for hardware accelerators. And the third technique is a source-to-source translator. I would say that in this third case, we are interested on an intermediate representation, which is Keras, TensorFlow, Lite, or NX, into another representation, which is ANSI C code. Why? Because in such a case, I don't need to vertically integrate the technology with a certain backend compiler. And since microcontroller uses lots of different compilers, different integrated development environments, then clearly to leave free the developers, the meta developer, to choose the IDE of the of their choice, the third technology, as I said, is important to the develop. And this was our choice. So the so-called STM32Cube.ai and the associated libraries that we develop as part of STM32CubeMX falls in the third case. Now, there is also another reason to develop a source-to-source translator. Is because essentially lots of optimizations, lots of decisions in the translation process can be taken offline. Just to remind, operator fusing, memory allocation, and various optimizations that can be efficiently implemented thanks to offline training, knowing that these are targeted to a certain family of microcontrollers. And STM32 is a family of microcontroller, however, with different kind of features. First of all, different kind of instruction sets, between the M0, the M4, the M7, the M33, the ARM Cortex family, and a different also memory layout that imposes optimizations that can be efficiently taken offline. Then the fifth step is to deploy the application on the field, because, and this is quite important, and sometimes it can be also frustrating, because maybe we see very nice performances on off-the-shelf data set or on data set that we build, but when we deploy on the field with by processing unseen data, then this become a challenge, because we are trying to make sure that the solution generalizes. And this is not obvious, because to generalize, this means that it should be capable to correctly classify a process data that were not part of the training set. And this may create also a continuous process back and forth between five, three, and four steps in order to continuously implement optimizations and improve the learning. So this is in general. Now, let me try to show you in practice in practice how the procedure is productive. And to show you this as an example, because I have still 15 minutes for this topic, I would like to take a common case, the CIFAR-10 dataset. It's well known. We know these are small images, color images, and 10 classes, different objects. And so, what does it take to develop a classifier, for example, that perform properly on the CIFAR-10 dataset? And how to deploy very rapidly an application that can be tested on the field in such a problem? So to make it short, let's go through those five steps. Obviously, the first and the second are de facto defined, because data set, the problem is well defined. Through a camera, I want to classify such an object. I have already the data set. So let me jump to the third step. In the third step, essentially, I need to develop a neural network. Now, here, what I'm sharing is a Colab template in which I modeled different neural networks to achieve the CIFAR-10 classification. So Google provided this nice way to allow to develop a neural network. Network through using various sources the data and prepare them for the training process. The network I'm showing here, in particular the model summary, is a quite complex network that try to classify the CIFAR-10. Quite complex, you see in terms of model lots of layers, and this is a quite complex one that achieve 80-85% accuracy with 876,000 parameters. Now, what does it mean, such a network? Well, such a network implies, for example, quite 900,000 parameters, and this is about, in floating point, a model that occupies 3.6 megabytes of flash. However, nothing is said about its complexity. Its complexity in terms of multiplication and additions, which dominate the complexity of the neural network, and the memory. So this is where the tool that we develop come into the picture. And so let me show you a very quick example. So first of all,
Danilo, one request. Yeah. So can you do the hide on that sharing one? Can you click on, because there is a one at the bottom. If you see, there is a hide. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, because you didn't see the screen so far.
No, some part was missing. So that's what.
Okay. Yeah. Now do you see the tool?
Yeah.
Okay, so let me show you a very simple example. On the camera, you see the IoT node is an STM32L4 node. So let me quickly show you how does it work. First of all, we select the board, and this is CubeMX. CubeMX is a free of charge tool that allows you to pick up one of the many microcontrollers belonging to the STM32 family. In this case, I'm using the IoT node and opening it in a standard configuration. Now, a new UI will come up and will show you the basic configuration. I can adjust the clock, I can select the pins and so on. But what interests me in this case is that I can select a software pack. And guess which software pack I'm going to select is the Xcube AI. In particular, the latest version that we just released a few days ago, the 7.1.0, which is composed on the core library, which does the source-to-source translation, and then some built-in application. One interesting application that allows you to avoid to write any code, any specialized code, is the validation. Now, let me just select it, and you will see in a while I am going to share to consider it, and then let me get the let me get into the UI associated to Xcube AI. So this is the subpart of Xcube AI, and let me import a network. For example, I already developed, trained the 800 kilo parameter neural network, and then accordingly to the procedure of TensorFlow, I also post-training quantized into integer 8. And this is quite obvious to do because it will reduce by effort the footprint. So what I get is, let me point to the model. And I'm going to the right folder where I stored my networks. So let me get the 800 kilo model. Now, you will see that I can also set a couple of features. In particular, I can drive the memory allocator in such a way that also the inputs and the outputs are allocated. I'm sorry, I see here strange enough. All the buffers are allocated in the same memory chunks, including the input and the output. And this creates a very compact memory layout. Automatically, the network will be profiled, and which means that the code will be generated, the C code will be generated, and the key complexity figures will be provided. In particular, the key figures are the flash occupation, the RAM footprint, and the complexity in terms of multiplication and additions. The analysis is about to finish. If we go through the, I don't want to read everything because it will be quite long, but if you see the key figures, this is about 335 million multiplication and additions. Unfortunately, the occupation in the flash is too big, and the tool will tell you that this network will not stay, will not fit into the memory, and into the memory, because this IoT node has an half megabyte of flash and 128 kilobyte of RAM. So no matter the optimization I applied on the buffer, it doesn't fit. Therefore, I need to come back to the network design and make sure that a tiny network is developed. This is the case. I already developed another one, which achieves 100,000 parameters using 2D convolution. Is essentially a hyperparameter optimized network made by a bunch of convolution 2D and dense layer. But I didn't stop myself here. I also wanted to replace Conv2D with separable convolutions. And what I get is an halved complexity model. So now I have three networks, the 800K parameters, the 100K parameters, and the 43K parameters, which are tinier and tinier in order to save memory. Now I go back. I delete, I don't consider anymore this network, and I load the next one, and in particular the model I just mentioned, the one with 100K parameters. So I analyze it, and in that case, you see that the previous network was over the RAM allowed into the chip, but in this case the situation will be much better, because now I'm using just 23 kilobyte of RAM with 100 kilobyte of flash, 100 kilo parameters, 8 bits, 100 kilobytes. Now, how to develop rapidly a prototype? First of all, I name my project, so test, let me call it test CIFAR-10. Let me choose the compiler. You see that different compilers can be used, be selected by a developer for STM32, so it doesn't make sense to vertically integrate with the compiler, and that's why we developed the tool which generate source code. So let me get the cube ID, which is for free, and let me generate the code. In such a way, the project will be automatically generated, and the C code will be prepared. It takes a little bit, but it's worth to show, because I want to demonstrate that I can start on-field trials without having a process which is mainly automatically performed, no matter what is the problem, okay, that I'm trying to solve. So essentially generate a bunch of C files plus the built-in validation application. So now the project has been generated and I automatically launch also the IDE. The IDE will open the project that I'm going to compile. Once I will compile the project, so I need to compile it. Then I will install the binary on the microcontroller. And then I will start my on-field tests. So now I'm going to finish the compilation. I have still 6 minutes left. Okay. Now the compilation and the binary has been generated. So I have the board connected and I'm going to flash it. So with the link utility, I'm going to CubeMX, test CIFAR10, debug, and this is the binary. So now I'm going to flash. I'm flashing the board with the binary. Now the things are pretty standard. This is done. I check just through the serial that the network has been, the firmware has been installed correctly by restarting the board. Okay. So you see that I just put this 100 kilobyte flash and 23 kilobyte network with 10 millions of multiply and accumulations. Now I disconnect the board and then I prepared a Conda environment where essentially I will launch a Python script, and this Python script essentially connect a webcam to the Nucleo board, the IoT board. Please notice that the IoT node doesn't have any interface or any built-in camera capability. So here the trick is to use a standard Nucleo board with standard connectivity with unforeseen sensors to be attached to it. And here I'm showing that by writing a simple Python script that interfaces through a standard protocol, which is part of the CubeAI delivery, any sensor can be connected, generate data, and stream to the board. So I installed my network. I select the label file. The label file essentially is a file that semantically associate the output of the softmax with a certain label. And then I can validate. For example, I created a CSV file with all with some test images, and such test images will be used to profile the network capabilities. So this is a sample of an example of a validation. Validation can happen in different ways. This is one way. In a while, we will see the output, because all the picture must be processed. It takes a little bit of time. Yes. Now you see that this is on the bottom right, the confusion matrix. And in this case, the network has been trained so that 88% of accuracy has been obtained. Okay. Notice that the inference time is also recorded, 350 milliseconds. If I would run the separable convolution version, this will be around 100 milliseconds. Now, I can do validation also in different ways. For example, I can pick up images that I stored on my PC, for example, a bird, and let it to classify, and then pick up another images, for example, a truck, and let it classify, and so on and so forth. But what is really a challenge is to do that on real images, because so far what I used were images from the test set in shaped in different way to perform a validation on the target, validation of the network which has been installed directly on the microcontroller. But now I need to use an off-the-shelf camera capturing live images. So I attach the webcam to my laptop, I am selecting it, and I start to it. So here you see, so this is my hand, I put the camera in front of different pictures that I printed. Okay, so now I go in loop. You will see another window appearing, and here images are captured live. Now I change the image. This is a horse, and you see that this is misclassified. Then I change it once again, and I have a track, and this is misclassified. Then I have, for example, a deer, and deer is sometime properly classified. Then I can get also a bird. Let me just quickly show you. The bird is properly classified. Let me go to the sheep. The sheep is classified. Let me get a cat. And the cat is misclassified. You see, I'm playing here and so on. So in let me get just another example. The dog. The dog is misclassified. So what does it mean? It means that you see that the live tests are a challenge. The field trials are a real challenge. While it seems that on the data set, everything worked nicely. 88% on CIFAR-10 with 100,000 parameter network is not that bad if you are familiar with such a problem, which seems simple, however, is not. Is definitely more complex and more challenging than the classic character recognition with MNIST dataset. However, the point is that by using a real camera and live images, then misclassification can happen. So this is why it is important to go through this process very quickly, because you don't want to spend 80-90% of your time shaping a very nice data set and then realizing on field trials that the performances are poor. You want, as any AI developer, make sure that all the procedure can be analyzed very quickly. And I think in 15 minutes I showed you how to build a project and to deploy a network. Obviously, it takes time to create such a Python script to interface the sensor with the IoT board. However, this is not a big deal for a Python programmer. The real point is that I want to quickly check if the network is performing properly on the field. And if not, to augment my data set, to increase it with more images, maybe taking also from the field, and go through this process as fast as possible. And I think that the solution we developed so far is productive in this sense, because it shortened a lot all the process, which was composed by the five steps I just mentioned. So for me, I would like to stop here for the first topic I wanted to show, which is the development of the rapid deployment of machine learning algorithms. I showed just neural networks. However, with XQBI 710, we do support also classic machine learning algorithms, support vector machine, regressors, random forest, PCA, and so on and so forth. So actually it's not only focused on neural network, but also on classic machine algorithm. But using the same methodology, okay? So this is the end of the first topic I wanted to show, and now I would like to go to the second topic.
So, Danilo, there are a couple of questions. I think Akash and Pratik has a couple of questions. Can we take those questions now?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So, Akash or Pratik, any one of you can go ahead.
Hi, Danilo. This is Pratik.
Hello.
Yeah. I just wanted to know, like, what are the extension files that can be imported? Like, we can import SD5 files as well, or like the TensorFlow files that we save. And is there any constraint on the size of files? Like, it can be in 100 MBs or something. So, is there any constraint on that?
The type of formats we support are listed here. We do support Keras, TensorFlow Lite, and Onyx. Keras and TensorFlow Lite are part of the Google offering. Onyx is the file format exported, can be exported through MATLAB, through Paddle, PyTorch, and MXNet, and the likes. Why we concentrated on this? Because the industry, the communities are actually using those formats for microcontrollers. So for us, it doesn't make sense to support, for example, the protobuffer, the PB, because the PB are not meant for resource-constrained devices. Therefore, we preferred to concentrate our attention on those, also because it has implications on the tool. The architecture, I didn't mention that, the architecture is composed by importers. So every time we want to interface with a new file format, we need to make sure that an associated importer is part of the tool. The importer generates an intermediate representation, which is our preferred intermediate representation. However, the importer is the bridge between the format and this intermediate representation. And we also checked with the community that there was no such a requirement to support other formats than those. New ones will appear in the future. For example, one of the formats that interests me is the QKeras. However, QKeras is a drop-in replacement of Keras, and therefore the file format is once again the Keras format. Why I mentioned QKeras? because this is particularly important for deeply quantized neural network. In deeply quantized neural network are instrumental to save complexity, power consumption, memory footprint. So sorry for my long reply, but what I wanted to underline is that we try to be as much as possible interoperable with the formats that have a direct impact on tiny devices. Sorry, the second question was,
is there any constraint on size, like the file size?
No, there are no constraints in the sense that the technology, the translation technology and the code generation technology by itself is not limited by the model size. You can have a different model size, for example, VGG, VGG19. There is no constraint. However, the tool, as you just saw before, it will report that the model size in terms of flash or RAM occupation overflow the available resources. So the technology is able to generate the C code and to profile it in terms of complexity and in terms of accuracy. However, since the tool is linked to a machine model, if the neural network exceeds the available resources of the microcontroller machine model, then it will tell so. And therefore, it will block the development, the deployment. Unless the device supports external memory. Not all the STM32 support external memory. There are few boards that use external flash and external RAM. In such a case, even if the model size exceeds the embedded memory constraints, it is possible to place such great buffers. For example, the VGG16 will need 100 of megabytes. So these models, these weights will be put in the external flash. You see here, there is a specific tab to enable weights placement on external flash. The same is true for RAM. Furthermore, we introduced with the new version the so-called memory pools. The memory pools means that you may use a microcontroller with fragmented memory, which means with memory chunks which are not contiguous in the address space. And so we need to properly take advantages of non-contiguous memory chunks because we want to place buffers here and there. Now, why there are non-contiguous memory chunks, that was a design choice on which we have to adapt. And the tool adapt also on that. I hope I elaborated your question.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So Danilo, are you using the two mics? Because there is slight echo is there. So can you just check it?
Say again?
There is some echo is there. Your voice is coming slightly. There are two versions of your voice. One is delayed by a few microseconds. So are you using two microphones there?
No, I'm using the microphone in the...
Okay.
On the headset. I'm sorry about this.
That is fine. There is a small thing is there. So Akash, you want to go ahead with the question?
Yes. So my first question is that do you have support for Prune-Keras networks or Prune-Keras models? And my second question is that how do you compare QBI against TensorFlow Lite Micro?
The first question is?
Do you have support for Prune-Keras networks, Prune models?
I'm not sure I understand the question. Which type of Keras model?
Pruned. Pruned. Pruning. Let me just type.
Ah, pruned. Pruned. Okay. Sorry for my better understanding. No, pruning is not... Let me set for myself the vocabulary. Pruning for me, just to create a common understanding, pruning for me is the process to achieve a sparse network. Then the net result, the object I need to handle is the sparse network. Pruning usually may involve fine-tuning or retraining and so on. Now, the tool is not, I need to say that, is not responsible for that, for retraining, for fine-tuning. This is a decision that we leave to the users. Having said that, even post-training pruning is not supported. Sparsity is not supported. And what does it mean? It means that if we have zero head weights, there is no actual, at this point in time, way to compress and to compact the memory. However, in the future version, we plan to support sparsity. At which level? Certainly at weight level, because sparsity can be easily implemented through lossless compression, lossless vector compression. Why I underline lossless? Because the tool shall not compromise the accuracy, because the accuracy is something a developer is really concerned about. Different words need to be spent on the activations. Sparse activations are hard to support because they may compromise a regular computing process. Now, if we compromise a regular computation, we may experience jumps on a microcontroller may generate may reduce the performances, because too many conditional, depending on the sparsity, execution will compromise the regularity of the computation and therefore it will diminish the performances. So in short, in the next versions, we will address sparsity, certainly through vector lossless quantization, lossless vector compression. Decompression can be done offline. The decompression must be very fast and tiny in order to not compromise the performances. Pruning, at the first glance, we would like to leave it to the developer in order to sign off the accuracy. Because if we start to compromise the accuracy into the tool, then we need to take the responsibility in front of the developer and justify, which is going to be tricky.
Okay, thanks, Daniel. My next question was, how do you measure power with this QBI? Is there a way to measure power? Can we have that?
QBI is essentially an additional package to automatically convert and validate and measure performances, but not the power consumption. However, QMX, which is the overall framework, has also tools to measure the power. So you can measure through QMX the power consumption once a solution is deployed.
Do we need a separate hardware for this, or we can have it on this using the nuclear board itself?
There is also a separate hardware. I can provide offline new information. Is an additional daughter board that allows to report. I use that board for the TinyML perf measurements. I have it in my lab, but I don't remember the name. Offline, I can provide you the name.
Is it LP04, I think? Okay.
Yeah, maybe. I'm sorry. Right now, I don't remember. But I have it in my lab, so if you want to discuss further, I'm available. I used it for the power measurements for the TinyML perf on the Nucleo STM to measure, to benchmark the four TinyML perf applications, which are standardized by ML Commons.
Right. These are the questions. Thanks, Andrew.
Daniel, just one request. Can you just try changing the microphone to the laptop one, just to see if there is any effect?
Select
in the microphone.
Microphone array. Okay. What about?
No.
It's not better.
No, the previous one is.
Let me change the headset. Because this is a session with the board which occupies the USB. Just let me change that.
Thanks.
Maybe this will be better. Yes. Just a second.
Maybe in the Zoom one, you need to change the microphone.
Hello.
Yeah, you are audible now.
Hello.
Yeah, you are audible.
Sumit, do you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Hello.
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, you are audible. Are you able to hear?
Yes.
Okay.
Sumit, I tried to change the headset.
That is fine.
I'm sorry, but
somehow this is working fine now, but let's see.
Yeah. Okay.
Sorry. Yeah.
No problem. I tried to change the headset, but it didn't work.
No issue.
I'm sorry for this. If you don't mind, if there are no other questions, I would like to change the topic.
Yes. Please go ahead. We can take the question later. Yeah.
Okay. So let me go to the next topic. Okay, so the next topic is about artificial intelligence computing for the sensors. So now this is really something even more challenging than implementing machine learning on microcontrollers. So let me go in slide mode. You see my slides?
Yes, it's
now. Sorry.
Yes, slides are visible.
Okay. So, what I would like to touch here is the topic of implementing neural networks for in-sensor computing, and this was done in liaison with some students here in Italy. And I would like to present you the main point. So let me focus on introducing deeply quantized neural network. Okay. So you know that I just mentioned the process of TensorFlow, based on TensorFlow to design a neural network. You can design, any one of us can design neural network using the TensorFlow process, converting at the end of the process into TensorFlow Lite, full floating point, 8-bit quantized, or going through the Keras process. Okay, this is all we know. We apply this on daily basis. However, we can only play with 8-bit quantized network. What if I need to adapt to sensors that produce, for example, 11 bits? Or 20 bits, or 16 bits, or 14 bits, okay? And there are lots of problems in machine learning where sensors generate a variable amount of bits. Now, I need a tool, a framework, to cope with such a variability. Fortunately, Google came to help with a new framework called QKeras. QKeras allows me to design a neural network using a variable number of bits, integer, between 1 and 32. So you see that being the most extreme side, the binary neural network. Binary means where activations and weight are just one bit, okay? This process is a training-aware quantization process. Because QKeras is a drop-in replacement of Keras functions. And therefore, the deeply quantized neural network are decompressed, dequantized into fake floating point and then used for a training aware quantization. Why training aware quantization? Because it is the best way to minimize the losses associated with this type deep quantization process. And an example of what is a deeply quantized, a QKeras neural network. So first of all, you recognize that the usual layers activation conv2D are are redefined as Q. Q means quantized, and we can quantize the activations through, for example, in these calls, these are 8-bit quantized, but I can select also different type of deep bit depth. In such a case, it means that since the fractional arithmetic is supported, I have a 7-bit fractional, 1-bit of sign, and zero for the integer part. And then through API, I can also fine-tune the bit depth for weights and biases. And by interleaving those in a topology, I can achieve a deeply quantized net. And therefore, when I print the summary of such a network, for example, in this case, 41,000 parameter networks, you see that the different operations uses different type of precision. For example, the first 2D convolutions uses sign and multiplication between 8 and 8 numbers. The third convolution uses XOR for processing binary inputs and so on and so forth. And then I can have also the print of the model summary, taking advantages by the fact that I have some weights in 8-1-bit and other in 8-bit. In such a way, I can have an heterogeneously quantized neural network. So remind, QKeras is one tool that we like at most. Now, what it matters when I try to implement artificial intelligence on a sensor? Well, you know, when we deal with a microcontroller, we have available huge resources. Obviously, less resources than a GPU, but huge resources because I have 1 megabyte of flash, few hundred kilobytes of RAM. I play with 100 microampere per megahertz in RAM mode. But when I play with a sensor, definitely I have 70 times smaller sites. Then I have one order of magnitude lower power consumption. I play with up to 10 kilobytes of memory. I don't have flash. And also the silicon processes are quite different. For example, a microcontroller is done in 90 or 65 nanometer technology. A sensor is using 130 nanometer technology. So what's the point here? The point is that imagine a micro machine. The micro machine occupies a lot of the silicon die. I have a very small space for any kind of logic, whatever is the logic is about. And therefore, the logic is constrained by the process, which is always taken at most by the micro machine, by the sensor itself. And this is a huge constraint that we don't have in a microcontroller, where all the silicon die is available for the digital part. And therefore, what are the requirements? Well, the die area must be lower than 2 square millimeter. The process, I said, 130 nanometer because it's low cost. And we cannot change the process. The power consumption has to be microwatt envelope, and the memory is very restricted, much more restricted and limited than the one I have in a microcontroller. So how to deal with such a very, very challenging requirement? For example, I need to investigate not tiny neural network, I call ultra tiny neural network due to this requirement. Now, what's the point of how to achieve an ultra tiny neural network? For example, the dream would be using binary neural network. We just introduced the Q-Keras and we saw that one extreme of the deep quantization is 1-bit neural network. Now, it's obvious why we would like, we love to go to 1-bit, because if we, for example, consider the complexity, multiplication and additions, and we go from 32-bit floating point to 8-bit floating point to 1-bit, so 8-bit integer to 1-bit, there is at least 3 order of magnitude saving in terms of power consumption. And the same applies through memory, being external or internal, but huge things, okay? Now, what does it mean to implement a binary neural network? Well, actually it means the multiply and accumulations are implemented through XNOR and leading bit count. So XNOR and pop count, very simple. There are huge saves, as we saw. There are no more multipliers because a neural network is dominated in its complexity by multiplier and accumulation. And they have huge things in terms of memory. On the other side, there are challenges. First of all, I need to make sure that the accuracy is kept. There is no point in binarizing or deeply quantizing a neural network and at the same time compromising the accuracy because it will not work. Secondly, in order to get advantages of such multiplier-less architecture, I need to have in the instruction set or in the hardware underlying hardware simple operators like XNOR, SIND, and so on. They need a compiler to support and to schedule properly those instructions. So let's take an example, the human activity recognition. Can recognize my activity if I'm running, standing, walking, and so on through an image camera. Our choice was using an inertial sensor. And the applications are different from healthcare, assisted living, fitness, and so on and so forth. So with an accelerometer, I want to classify my activity. Now, I need to take in consideration also another thing. The accelerometer, the inertial sensor embodies not only the accelerometer, but also the gyroscope. And this implies different power consumption envelope. For example, only accelerometer, just 10 microampere. Accelerometer plus gyroscope, up to 0.5 milliampere. So you see that there are different hotspots to be addressed as far as only the sensor is concerned. So for that, we conceived 3 architecture that I'm showing very briefly here. Essentially, is a neural network that is capable to handle with or without preprocessing only the accelerometer or also the gyroscope. And there are different compromises. Why we investigated such 3 cases? Because in the sensor, we got the accelerometer and the gyroscope. We got both a different power consumption, but I need to play in low power mode or in high performance mode. But what are the implications of such a configuration in terms of processing? Well, tricky part is the preprocessing. What does the preprocessing, if I'm using just the accelerometer? It does 2 things. First of all, it implements an high-pass, low-pass filter because I need to separate the gravity from the other frequencies. And secondly, I need to align the package related reference system to the Hertz fixed reference system, which means that through the Rodrigues formula, I need to rotate the local reference system to the gravity one, okay, to the Hertz fixed one. So these are the 2 functions, filtering stage and vector rotation. They need to be performed in the processing. Now, when I go to an implementation of the preprocessing, there are a few things to pay attention. First, there is no point of using floating point 32-bit precision or double precision because it's too costly in different ways. So I need to implement with fractional arithmetic. Now, what is the right fractional arithmetic I need to address? We did a different experiment. it's mandatory to avoid a cutoff frequency deviation of more than 1% and to ensure the border stability check, which was obtained with 8.16 bits, so in total 24 bits, which means that the arithmetic to implement the preprocessing we choose was 24 bits. Then a neural network. At a glance, the neural network would seem a trivial, well-known convnet. However, if I implement a full floating point convnet, which is in blue here, I obtain nice performances on public dataset like PAMAP2 and SHL. Then, if I want to binarize all layers, weights and activation, the accuracy miserably drop. So this is not a choice. I can regain in yellow some accuracy if I keep batch normalization in float and the inputs are not binarized. This is a bad idea in any case, to binarize the input. However, not at the satisfactory level. So the best we achieved is by interposing binarization, which means sign extraction, only to few layers, where after the first convolution layer, after the batch normalization. The batch normalization is very important. If we binarize without batch normalization, results will be quite poor. And after the first fully connected layer. What is the advantage in terms of computation? Is that 62% of the operation are binarized. If 62% of the operation are binarized, it means that 62% of the computation is multiplier less. And this is quite important, assuming that my hardware will implement such operators. Then we tested the accuracy with k-fold procedure on different dataset. I said PAMAP2, N5, and with 5, 12 activity, SHL with 8 activity. What are the main findings? I think you can see here, with the end, let's focus on the end. On the end, you see that the preprocessing is very helpful to achieve nice performances. While without the preprocessing, no. Why? Because rotations, which affect the end, need to be properly handled. How? Through the preprocessing, through the filtering stage and the vector rotation. On the other side, if I wear the inertial on the chest, the vice versa happens. So the preprocessing, since there are no rotations on the chest, just introduce noise. This noise will confuse the network and the performance will diminish. While without preprocessing, using only the accelerometer, some performances will be lifted. In all cases, the best is achieved by using also the gyroscope without the preprocessing. The point is that obviously I will consume more power consumption. What is the point also to use the gyroscope is that will increase the computation. Well, how much? By the operation will be doubled, and the memory, the weight memory, will be increased by 75%. However, in absolute sense, we are speaking about 1 kilobyte parameter memory or 1.7 kilobyte memory, which is very tiny. And then in terms of computation, we are speaking about 25 to 50,000 operation per sample. For example, we sample the accelerometer at 25 Hertz. So 25 kilo samples means, kilo ops means 25 kilohertz. So you know that the power consumption is linearly dependent by the frequency. If by construction, the operations per sample are very low, the power consumption of any implementation will be very low by construction. Then I need to define an hardware which is ultra low power. But at least my algorithm is very tiny in terms of abstracted operations and in terms of abstracted memory. That's why deeply quantized network and in particular semi-binarized neural network are very important, because by contraction offers such an advantage, at least in this case study. Okay, then we did an hardware implementation. Just going through very simple, The other implementation was multi-cycles. With a few multipliers and others, we implemented the preprocessing. This is the preprocessing for the vector rotation and for the filtering using 24-bit arithmetic. And then the hardware for the neural network. In this case, is three cores. These are symmetrical, getting data through a SIPO from the preprocessing, using FIFOs and RAM to store weights and to store intermediate data. And the cores are as simple as a triadder. So you see that by carefully analyzing the accumulation of the computation inside the different stages, which was 16 bits at maximum, just a three-level triadders was enough for the implementation. Then it's a choice to use a full FIFO type of architecture or mixed FIFO RAM in order to achieve different configurations. Now, implementation. Let's imagine that we use a 65 nanometer HVT technology. If we address 1.5 label per second at 260 kilohertz operating sequence, operating frequency, we got 16.9 total power consumption. However, you must note that 6-7 microwatts are just related to the leakage. So the leakage is something that we cannot cope with because it's depending on the process. But inherently, the dynamic power is very low and is on the same envelope of the low power configuration mode for the accelerator. This assuming a full switching node activity for all the node, which is not realistic. If we go in a realistic case, so using test pattern from the data set to stimulate the hardware implementation, the power consumption drops to 6 microampere. So really it's possible to achieve a microwatt power consumption for such deeply quantized neural network. In such a case, we use the TCMC Europractice, which is not at all optimized in terms of leakage. And even that, the low complexity of the neural network by construction was enabling such a good result. Then this was for classification. The same can be achieved for fault detection, for anomaly detection, for example, to detect anomaly detection on bearings, okay? In such a case, we added an autoencoder to the classifier. So the previous architecture was reused to solve another problem. Essentially, the problem is to detect faults in the bearings vibrations and then to classify them. So in principle, the processing is like that. I use an autoencoder, semi-binarized, to detect anomalies. Once the anomaly is detected, which happens asynchronously versus the fault detection approach, a classifier is invoked in order to classify the type of fault. Now, the encoder and decoder were hardwareized using the same architecture, the same symmetricity of the hardware I just exposed. The classifier, since has to be very accurate, and since to be accurate use the floating point precision, we implemented on a microcontroller. Therefore, the encoder and decoder were conceived to be designed and to be integrated in the sensor itself, using the same requirements as before. But the classifier is left to the microcontroller, to which the sensor is assumed to be attached. And here you get the result. The autoencoder actually has an area under curve of 0.99, while the classifier, assuming that classify a windows of features of size 600, achieve about 95% of accuracy classification on the microcontroller. I'm going skipping some implementation detail here, but I wanted to show a couple of things which are very relevant. look at the power consumption. The power consumption I got essentially on a very tiny FPGA, 0.122 watt, about 107 milliwatt were of quiescent power. This leave 15 milliwatt on the FPGA of dynamic power consumption. So everything was quiescent, actually. And this good result has been obtained thanks to the hybridization and binarization of the neural network. When we go to the implementation on the microcontroller, check. Since this is classifier is asynchronously invoked, this just need less than 700 kilohertz to implement, which equates to 82 microampere in run mode. With in and this is performed in less than 9 milliseconds. So, which means that the MCU is really underused or can serve many more processes in parallel. Okay. Now, how do we move from these results to research? Here is the point I would like to make. We announced a few in December, between December and November, a new product called IIS3IS, also known as ISPU, which integrate on the same die of an inertial sensor, a proprietary DSP, which is able to work at 5 up to 10 megahertz, which is able to accelerate a binary network. This product has been announced and will be available in the next month and uses just 400 kilobytes of memory. There are huge benefits in terms of power consumption, at least one order of magnitude, even compared to a Cortex-M0. And you see that there are tenfold improvements in terms of size and execution time if a network would be fully banalized. If a network is partially banalized in some realistic application, good performances like tenfold size and 30% of execution time can be achieved. So this concluded the second section. I hope I just gave you some information about what it takes to bring a neural network implementation for in-sensor computing from research to production. And that's concluded the second topic I wanted to talk about. Is there any question or should I move to the third topic?
I think we can move to the third topic.
Okay.
Yeah, we have less time, so we can move to the third.
Okay. So, this the third topic, which is also something to be considered, is the following. Now, the point is how to design a neural network. And today we know that to design a pipeline, this is essentially an uncrafted process. An uncrafted process is subject to the results achieved by the AI developer that sometimes are not reproducible, are subjective. And more than that, cannot be automatized. If it cannot be automatized, is not that much productive. So the real topic is how to make productive the design of a neural network. Now, we know that exist tools like AutoML to achieve that. The point here is to design a neural network which can be deployable on a microcontroller. So there is no free lunch, unfortunately, because all the solution that we can find on a problem for as far as machine learning is concerned takes the same complexity. There is no shortcut. And therefore, also, There are a lot of variable performances depending on the parameter that characterize a machine learning model. So there are three challenges: how to select the model, how to select the hyperparameters, and how to combine both. AutoML is one of these, is the answer to this problem, because automatically allows us to design a machine learning algorithm and tune the hyperparameter in order to achieve proper performances measured empirically on a dataset. When it's specialized to neural networks, this is commonly known as neural architecture search. Now, neural architecture search is composed by the iteration, and here is quite synthesized the process, by iteration controlled by a so-called network controller that on epochs try to generate a child model, train it, evaluate the performance, and iterate until a proper topology is conceived. Okay, fine. We know that this exists, and there are different approaches that can be used, such as reinforcement learning, evolutionary model, some are heuristic search, and so or gradient-based optimizations, and so on. However, a de facto standard technique is the Bayesian optimization. Bayesian optimization has been proved since a lot of years to achieve state-of-art performance in automatizing the neural network design. There are also tools that allows us to automatize such a design: Google AutoML, Vizier, Amazon SageMaker, Azure Machine Learning. There are some open source projects: AutoKeras, Keras Tuner, Neural Network Intelligence. Such libraries really allows to synthesize automatically neural network pipeline. Also, we try to use them. What is the cons? The cons is that there is no guarantee that the result is deployable on a microcontroller. Typically, these tool generate pipelines which are not constrained in terms of complexity. Yes, maximize the accuracy. However, under the assumption that there are unlimited resources available to implement the inference. Where are these typically available, these resources? On the cloud. On the cloud because I have the GPUs, I have the tensor processing unit, I have lots of storage resources that are available on the cloud. However, there are also approaches that are appearing to address the neural architecture search targeting microcontrollers. There are few works in the state of the art, like MCUNET, Micronas, MCNET, that tries to automatically on CIFAR10, on ImageNet, to automatize the process of designing a tiny neural network, which is by construction deployable on the microcontroller. So really, this is what we need in order to make productive the process. Now, most of those are not based on Bayesian optimization. Now, there is a discrepancy. I just said that the Bayesian optimization is the de facto standard for AutoML, but when we go to the state of the art for automated machine learning for microcontroller, as you saw in the state of the art, there is no Bayesian approach that have been used so far. And why I am insisting on the Bayesian optimization? Well, you see in a while, because let's imagine that I want to optimize my neural network in order to select the right hyperparameter. This is not a trivial job because I need to find the proper set of a parameter which minimize the accuracy of a topology trained on a certain data set and validated on a certain data set, okay? Through a quite complex process, which is the k-fold cross-validation. And you know, the k-fold cross-validation is a time-consuming process. And in fact, one of the technology, neural architecture search, is one of the main driver, which demonstrated through the year to require more and more flops to implement that. So what is one easiest and largely adopted way to solve the HPO problem? Grid search. Grid search, however, is highly inefficient. Why I say that? Let's implement that I want to use grid search through 10 budgeted configuration. So I have, this is on X, the hyperparameter values, on Y, the accuracy. I sample 10 points, okay, 1, 2 to 10. And I need to maximize the accuracy, which means to minimize the validation loss. And let's imagine that 0.7 is the best configuration over the grid. Unfortunately, the accuracy curve is non-linear, and therefore I have an optimum which maximizes the accuracy in a point which doesn't lie between the 10 points I selected. So what it means? It means that the 10 trials are not enough and are not usable to achieve the maximum accuracy. So why Bayesian optimization came to help? Because it's a sample efficient global optimization strategy for a function that shows multiple extremes and for a process that essentially is a black box. And the k-fold validation training and validation process is essentially a black box process. And therefore, what I'm stating is that, as well known, the SMBO process will certainly exceed the performances of the grid search. And in fact, as I was saying, this is a de facto standard in AutoML. So let's go through. Let's imagine that I take three configurations, okay, 1, 2, 3, and these are randomly chosen. And then imagine that I use a Gaussian process to approximate the accuracy curve. So in blue, I have my prediction curve with a certain uncertainty, which is the blue shaded area, okay? So the key idea here is to play with uncertainty and be optimistic with it. So for example, let's take the upper bound of the shaded area where I have the maximum accuracy given the uncertainty of the current regression I'm playing with, okay? So this mechanism is known as upper confidence bound, and I will sample here a point and evaluate the accuracy, and then I will update my regression model. Therefore, the uncertainty will change, the blue shaded area will change, and this will allow me to step up after step to play with different sample points which are mainly driven by the upper confidence bound, and so on and so forth, up to the 10, and I will get the optimum, which was not able to achieve with the grid search. And you see in the previous example. So the best Bayesian optimized configuration exceeded the grid search one. Now, the point is, I need to search a space in terms of hyperparameter, which is complex because can be discrete. I can play with a certain number of neurons, can be continuous. The values can change continuously, for example, the learning rate, but can be conditional. And therefore, I'm calling in another meeting, so trying to conclude. And therefore, I have a conditional process, which means that instead of using a Gaussian process regressor, I will use a tree-structured decision tree, random forest process. So what does it mean? It means that, first of all, I need to find regions where the deployability cannot be ensured. Because if I play without deployability constraints, I could achieve a configuration. But certainly is not granted that this will be deployable, which means it will not be deployable on the microcontroller. At the point that I could have a best grid search result that could be deployable. So, which means that I need to include deployability constraints in the Bayesian approach. We know that CubeAI produces a number of measurement, accuracy, complexity reports, validation accuracy that are useful constraints to drive the Bayesian approach. And therefore, I can factor this into my process, and what it will obtain is the following. First of all, I take four random configurations. For example, three of those are deployable, one not. The second is not deployable because it doesn't fit, the neural network doesn't fit the microcontroller resource. This allows me to define a non-deployable region, and then I will start sampling in a hierarchical way this region in order to let it shrink and expand, in order to fine-tuning what are the non-deployable regions, in order to exclude what hyperparameter range I should not investigate anymore. And then, when I clearly defined the non-deployable regions, focus on the deployable region using the constrained Bayesian process I just described before. And this will allow me to find the best accuracy, which is not the same accuracy I could achieve, would be lower, without constraints. Going through very, very quickly to experiment. The hyperparameter space is huge in terms of values. Imagine the filter for the convolutions. Imagine the filter size, the activation, the kernel size, the pooling, the dropout, but also the learning rate, the optimizers, and so on. So this is just an example. And what if I try to implement a human activity recognition pipeline, which is a ConvNet, on an L4 or an F3? The L4 is quite, is providing good resources, 128 kilobytes of RAM, 1 megabyte of flash, while the F3 is much more constrained, just 16 kilobytes of RAM and 64 kilobytes of flash. So clearly, the pipeline as it is not deployable, okay? Even if I use some of the advanced feature of the XCube AI. But the problem is not XCube AI. The problem is that it is hard to find the hyperparameters in a huge space that allows me to find a configuration that is deployable. So with the approach I just showed, the hierarchical based Bayesian optimization using the random forest in order to implement the accuracy regressor and not the Gaussian progress process regressor, then the following was where the result. Up to the point, we could automatically generate a pipeline with a proper set of hyperparameter. Let me focus your attention on this, on the compression 8. Here. So automatically, the tool found the proper set of hyperparameter with compression of factor 8 of the weight in the dense layer, in order to achieve a marginal difference in terms of accuracy versus the pipeline, however, with a drastic reduction of the resources, which were 24 kilobytes of RAM and 375 kilobytes of flash compared to the baseline, which means that the network was fitting at the end on the F3. And you see from the results that the accuracy was 91.4%, 5 kilobytes of RAM, 50 kilobytes of flash, compared to the resources of the F3, which were respectively 16 kilobytes of RAM and 64 kilobytes of flash, with a complexity which was drastically reduced compared to the baseline. The baseline was about 900 kilo multiplication and addition per second. So all in one, these demonstrate that the process can be automated. And there are a few papers that we published so far. And all in one, I would like to say that as soon as these tools will become viable and commercial, I think great productivity will be added to the overall process and in terms of ecosystem. So we need to look overall to the ecosystem of the machine learning, because clearly Xcube AI has optimized the process of deploying and automatically deploying and validating a neural network on the microcontroller, as I shown at the beginning. But this generated another bottleneck. What is the bottleneck? The process of designing the neural network, which through these works and this concept I briefly introduced, can be automatized. Then, if we bring also deeply quantized network in the picture, even more hyperparameter will be added to the design process, which will make even more urgent the availability of such tools. Thanks so much for all the time that you devoted to listen to me. I'm sorry if I took so much time of your and it was a real pleasure to have this possibility to stay with
you. Thank you very much, Daniel. I think you gave us some of the latest things which are happening in the industry. in the AGI domain. I think this is quite new about including the AutoML, and where you added your own approaches for the microcontroller, so that the networks can be designed keeping the resource contents of the microcontroller in hand. This is quite interesting and something which is quite new to us also. So in case audience has any question, feel free to ask. Yeah, Professor Manoj.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm glad and excited to listen such a wonderful talk. So thanks a lot to the speaker. It was very informative, very useful, and we came to know the kind of work the ST technology is going to do. So I have a small question, Kari, though the time exceeded very much. Can we move to the second presentation?
Yes.
And on to the slide where we have seen these multi-stage neural networks, encoder, decoder, classification.
Yeah, this which slide you want?
Where to we have the encoder, decoder, classification.
Okay. I think you are referring to this one.
Yes. So I was just curious to know that we are getting this information of decoding as well as classification from the same encoded information, isn't it?
Yeah, in detail, the pipeline is the following. Yeah.
So I was just interested to know the inside design of this one, because when we are decoding, of course, we have some encoded bits and we can decode them. Fine.
Yes.
And we are classifying. So there would be certain number of bits in the encoded number itself, which we'll use to classify. So I was just curious to know that the bits required for decoding and bits required for classification are interleaved, or they are the separate but just clubbed up together.
The main difference between what it feeds the decoder and what it feeds the classifier Yes. Just the amount of compact features.
Yes, yes.
In one of my previous slides, I was showing that, let me try to go there. So the difference is that we send to the classifier more compact feature than the decoder. For example, to the decoder, we send just a compact information which is generated by the comp2d. While we accumulate those over the time in order to feed the classifier. Let me show you how many, because it was reported here. Mm-hmm. So here, the point is here. If we, just let me show this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if we, for example, the decoder is fed by an input window 24 features. But if we feed the classifier with those, the accuracy is very poor. So we accumulated more features in a bigger tensor, and then we feed the classifier up to 600. And we saw that 600 shape was the limit to achieve the maximum performances of the classifier. So the features are the same, are accumulated over the time, the one that feed the classifier.
No, no, sir, this thing is clear. My question was that the input what we are having in the encoded bits, are we have separate bits which we are feeding to decoder and separate bits to classifier, or we are using some common bits as well?
No, the representation
design,
is the same.
Hardware design. I'm asking at the hardware design point that are we...
From the hardware design point... just a second. From the hardware design point is this one. Is a 16-bit architecture.
Okay.
Is essentially is a 16-bit architecture. So the output of the let's say the 600 windows of the 24 windows is composed by 16 bits sample.
Here we are looking only the encoder and decoder part, no?
The
classifier part is not visible here.
The classifier is implemented in software on the microcontroller. So there is a silicon design for the encoder and decoder. And then there is this buffer essentially.
Actually that diagram was giving the feeling that both things are happening in the hardware itself.
No, sorry for this misunderstanding. Essentially, a buffer for 600 features feed the microcontroller, which does the CNN head, so the classifier.
Okay.
While 24 feed the decoder. And these features are 16 bits.
Okay. Fine.
Okay. Did I answer to your question?
Yeah,
okay.
I got the answer correctly. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for your question, Professor.
Yeah. Welcome, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Danilo. Thank you very much. So can you please